And welcome to another Bethel Park Library virtual story time. I'm sorry that we still can't be together in person, but I love that we're sharing stories this way. Today I wanted to dedicate, like kind of do a tribute story time to one of my favorite authors and illustrators of all time, Tommy DePaola. So Tommy DePaola was the author and illustrator of all of his books, right? So we know that that means he wrote the words and drew the pictures for all of his stories, which is pretty cool. And Tommy was a man of Italian and Irish heritage, so a lot of his stories are about his family and what it was like growing up with Italian and Irish grandparents. And then some of his stories are just made up, but they're all rich in that tradition and in that sense of family, which is probably why I like them so much. One of his most popular ones that you probably already know is Schräge Nonna. And we're going to end story time with that one today. But I wanted to start story time with a few of his lesser known books. And the first one is called Charlie Needs a Cloak. And you might be asking yourself, what exactly is a cloak? Well, a cloak is like a coat or a jacket without any sleeves. So maybe it's more like a cape, right? But it's a cape that would come in the front and the back. I brought a cloak in today to show you. Here's a cloak that I sometimes wear. I don't know if you can tell. Let me try to put it on here, and then you'll see what I mean. It's a coat that keeps you warm. But it doesn't have any sleeves. Let's see. What do you think? So I wear this a lot in the fall and in the winter. There's my cloak. Let's read about Charlie's cloak. Charlie was a shepherd. That means he took care of sheep, right? He had a cozy house, a big hat, a crook, and a flock of fat sheep. But everyone said, Charlie needs a cloak. This one looks pretty beat up, I guess, doesn't it? Yeah, it looks like it's shredding and it's really falling apart. Poor Charlie. I wonder why his cloak was falling apart. Do you think the sheep maybe tear at it when they jump up on him? That's what I'm thinking. He really needed a new cloak. So, in the spring, Charlie sheared his sheep. That means he shaved off the wool. He washed the wool. He carded the wool to straighten it out. And carding the wool kind of means like when you just brush it out. So he's brushing out all the curl and making it straight. Then Charlie spun the wool into yarn. You can see that's what he's doing over here. Here's some spools of the yarn that he already spun. Charlie wanted a red cloak, so he picked some pokeweed berries during the late summer and boiled them over a fire. Then Charlie dyed the yarn red in the berry juice. Can you see the pot of boiled berries that he dyed it in? So here it's white. He dips it in there, and you can see when he's hanging it up over here, it's red. It's changed color. After the yarn was dry, Charlie put the strands on the loom. And every fall evening, he wove the yarn into cloth. So you can see him sitting over here at the loom. There's a pedal that he has to work with his foot. And this is kind of how he does it, how he makes the big pieces of cloth. Charlie put the cloth on the table and cut it into pieces. He pinned the pieces together and sewed them. And then When winter came, Charlie had a beautiful new red cloak. There it is, and he made it. He sewed it all by himself, start to finish. But uh-oh, boys and girls, do you notice what I do? I know, look at the sheep nibbling again already. Oh dear. Do you know something else funny about this book that I like, boys and girls, that I always like to point out? If you notice, if you look very carefully, on every single page, the mouse appears. So on this one, it's kind of hard to tell, but he's right down there in the corner. Do you see him? On this page, he's down there in the corner again, and he's stealing a bar of soap, isn't he? That's what he's carrying. And it's funny because on every page, that mouse creeps away with something else. You have to notice it, but it's there on every single page. And so when we get to the end of the story, right, where it becomes wintertime, you see what he was doing with those things in his little mouse house. He carried all those items to his own little mouse house, and he has his own little collection there. I thought that was something kind of clever. All right, boys and girls. So have you ever tried sewing anything on your own? If you have a family member who knows how to sew, you're very lucky because then they could teach you. But even if you don't know how to sew, we can all do a very, very basic sewing project, kind of like the one that I started last night. I decided to make a sheep pattern to go along with our story. And I just did it using an old piece of cardboard that I had laying around my house. And I'm not a very good drawer, but I knew this would be easy because you really just have to start with a big cloud shape. Right? So that's all that a sheep is a big cloud shape. And then I added a head and, of course, some legs. I started to color him. So you could draw this at home, or you can make any animal or any object that you wanted. But if you want to draw it first on a piece of cardboard or paper or cardstock, if you had it. And then after you draw your thing, you, of course, want to cut it out, right? And then I was going to color mine. You can see that I started the face. I would want to finish coloring that body with a white crayon. And then when I was all done, I would take a hole punch and I would punch holes in my sheep all the way around. And I would do it about an inch apart, right? And if you wanted to be really exact, you could take a ruler and actually measure, and you could really make sure they are exactly 1 inch apart. And I would just keep punching my holes all around the outline of my sheep. So I did that last night. You can see my holes. And then I happened to have some white yarn, which was perfect. And I took my yarn, I cut out a long piece, and I started threading it in and out of the holes. In and out, all the way around till I came to the end where I tied a knot. And then I had this leftover yarn, and I thought, wouldn't it be cute if I could use the leftover yarn to make like an extra fluffy tail for my sheep. So that's what I did just by winding it around one of the humps there. You kind of just have to wind and then tuck, and you can have a fluffy little tail for your sheep too. So that's a very basic, but fun sewing project that any of us can do with a grown-up's help, right? If you're cutting out on a piece of cardboard or trying to punch holes in cardboard, it is going to be a little more tricky. It's going to be more difficult because the paper is thicker, so you might want to get a grown-up to help you there. That was my sheep, and then I thought, maybe to go along with Charlie's cloak, he would want a pair of pants. So we could draw a pair of pants, too. Cut out that outline. Color them. If we wanted it to match, we could color it red, right? I would punch holes again all along the outline of the pants, and then I would use red yarn. So we could sew pants or sew sheep or any other objects we like. I thought that was a fun activity to go along with that story. My next Tommy DiPola book is called The Art Lesson. And this is one of my favorites too. I hope you'll enjoy it. knew he wanted to be an artist when he grew up. He drew pictures everywhere he went. It was his favorite thing to do. His friends had favorite things to do, too. Jack collected all kinds of turtles. Herbie made huge cities in his sandbox. Jeannie, Tommy's best friend, could do cartwheels and stand on her head. But Tommy drew and drew and drew. I like this page because what is he drawing? He's drawing pictures of his friends. There's his friend Jack with a turtle. There's his friend Herbie with this awesome sandcastle. And here he drew Jeannie doing cartwheels and standing on her head. And then this is someone named Maureen. That might be his little sister. His twin cousins, who were already grown up, were in art school learning to be real artists. They told him not to copy and to practice, practice, practice. And so he did. Tommy put his pictures up on the walls of his half of the bedroom. So he shares the bedroom with somebody, right? You can see there's two beds. On his half, he hangs all of his beautiful artwork. His mom put them up all around the house. His dad took them to the barber shop where he worked. Tom and Nana, Tommy's Irish grandfather and grandmother, had his pictures in their grocery store. Nana Fall River, his Italian grandmother, put one in a special frame on the table next to the photograph of Aunt Chloe in her wedding dress. So everybody's proudly displaying his artwork, right? And I think he's pretty good. Once Tommy took a flashlight and a pencil under the covers and drew pictures on his sheets. But when his mom changed the sheets on Monday and found them, she said, "No more drawing on the sheets, Tommy." His mom and dad were having a new house built, so Tommy drew pictures of what he thought it would look like when it was finished. When the walls were up, one of the carpenters gave Tommy a bright piece of blue chalk. Tommy took the chalk and drew beautiful pictures all over the unfinished walls. But when the painters came, his dad said, "That's it, Tommy. No more drawing on the walls." Tommy couldn't wait to go to kindergarten. His brother Joe told him that there was a real art teacher who came to the school to give art lessons. "When do we have our art lessons?" Tommy asked the kindergarten teacher. "Oh, you won't have your art lessons until next year," said Miss Bird. "But we are going to paint pictures tomorrow." It wasn't much fun. The paint was awful, and the paper got all wrinkly. Miss Bird made the paint by pouring different colored powders into different jars and mixing them with water. The paint didn't stick to the paper very well, and it cracked. If it was windy when Tommy carried his picture home, the paint blew right off the paper. "At least you get more than one piece of paper in kindergarten," his brother Joe said. "When the art teacher comes, you only get one piece." Tommy knew that the art teacher came to the school every other Wednesday. He could tell she was an artist because she wore a blue smock over her dress, and she always carried a big box of thick colored chalks. Once, Tommy and Jeannie looked at the drawings that were hung up in the hallway. They were done by the first graders. "Your pictures are much better," Jeannie told Tommy. "Next year, when we have real art lessons, you'll be the best one." Tommy could hardly wait. He practiced all summer. Then, on his birthday, which was right after school began, his mom and dad gave him a box of 64 Crayola crayons. Regular boxes of crayons had red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet, brown, and black. But this box had so many other colors: blue-violet, turquoise, red-orange, pink, and even gold, silver, and copper. "Class," said Miss Landers, the first grade teacher, Next month, the art teacher will come to our room. So on Monday, instead of singing, we will practice using our crayons. On Monday, Tom brought his 64 crayons to school. Miss Landers was not pleased. "Everyone must use the same crayons," she said. "School crayons." School crayons only had the same 8 old colors. As Miss Landers passed them out to the class, she said, "These crayons are school property, so do not break them, peel off the paper, or wear down the points." "How am I supposed to practice being an artist with school crayons?" Tommy asked Jack and Herbie. "That's enough, Tommy," Miss Landers said, "and I want you to take those birthday crayons home with you and leave them right there." And Joe was right. They only got one piece of paper. Finally, the day of the art lesson came. Tommy could hardly sleep that night. The next morning, he hid the box of 64 crayons underneath his sweater and went off to school. He was ready. Oh, boys and girls, I don't know if he should have done that. Miss Landers told him to take his box of crayons home and leave them there. But he's so excited for this art lesson. He sneaks them under his sweater. Can you see his big belly? Uh-huh. The crayons are under there. The classroom door opened and in walked the art teacher. Miss Landers said, "Class, this is Miss Bowers, the art teacher. Patty, who is our paper monitor this week, will give out one piece of paper to each of you. And remember, don't ruin it because it is the only piece you'll get. Now, pay attention to Mrs. Bowers." "Class," Mrs. Bowers began, "because Thanksgiving is not too far away, we will learn to draw a pilgrim man, a pilgrim woman, and a turkey. Watch carefully and copy me." Copy? Copy? Tommy knew that real artists didn't copy. This was terrible. This was supposed to be a real art lesson. He folded his arms and just sat there. "Now what's the matter?" Miss Landers asked. Tommy looked past her and spoke right to Mrs. Bowers. "I'm going to be an artist when I grow up, and my cousins told me that real artists don't copy. And besides, Miss Landers won't let me use my own 64 Crayola crayons." "Well, well," Mrs. Bowers said, "what are we going to do?" She turned to Miss Landers and they whispered together. Miss Landers nodded. "Now, Tommy," Mrs. Bowers said, "it wouldn't be fair to let you do something different from the rest of the class. But I have an idea. If you draw the pilgrim man and the pilgrim woman and the turkey, and if there's any time left, I'll give you another piece of paper and you can do your own picture with your own crayons. Can you do that?" "I'll try," Tommy said with a great big smile. That's a pretty good deal. He'd have to do everything else that the class was doing, but then at the end, he could do his own. Let's see what he makes. He did. Here's his Thanksgiving picture that Mrs. Bowers taught the entire class. And then here is his own picture that he drew at the end of class. Who did he draw? Look closely, boys and girls. Yes, he decided to draw a picture of Mrs. Bowers. We know that's her because of the blue smock, right? If we turn the page just to check, right? We can see that that's what she's wearing. And it's the same hair and she has those earrings. He chose to put Mrs. Bowers in a garden and she's picking some beautiful flowers. Wow, Tommy really is a great artist. And guess what? He still is. He still does his drawings every day. So this is a picture of Tommy when he's all grown up, when he became that author and that illustrator, right? So that goes to show you what practicing does. If you really enjoy something and you work hard at it and you practice, 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 you can do it for the rest of your life. Just like Tommy. That was a true story of him growing up in the art lesson. I love this book for so many reasons, but it's really timely for me to read it to you now, boys and girls, because guess what? The Bethel Park Library has an art gala coming up. It's one of our favorite things that we do throughout the year. And even though we can't do it in person this year, we decided we will do it online. So anybody can email me, and I'm going to run my email address here at the bottom of the screen, email me a picture of their artwork to Volpe E, which is my last name and first initial, Volpe E, at einetwork.net. I'm going to take all those pictures that you guys send me, and I was going to put it into a video, but friends of ours, Susie Hernishin, SJH Design, offered to make us a website. So we're going to upload all of your artwork to this beautiful website to share with everybody, and you can view it that way. So if you like to draw like Tommy did, right, or if you like to paint or sculpt or sew, I want you to do it. I want you to work on it, and I want you to send me a picture of it. Don't forget in the email to include your first name and your age. If you want to title your piece of artwork, you can do that. And then at the end of the month or the beginning of May, we'll put all the beautiful artwork up on this website. Okay? So that's something for you to work on at home. I'm so excited to see what you make. All right. The next Tommy DiPaola book that I want to read to you is a newer one of his, and it's called Quiet. I love this book because it really allows us to think about what it means to just sit quietly and really just enjoy the things around us, take time to think and to enjoy one another and to enjoy what we see around us. "My, oh my," the grandfather said, "everything is in such a hurry." It's like they're maybe going for a walk. "The birds are flying so fast." "And our dog is rushing after the ball," said the girl. "I see a frog jumping high into the pond," said a boy. "And a dragonfly zooming over the water." Everything's in motion, huh? Everything's moving about. "Even the trees are waving their leaves." "Busy, busy, busy. Busy as busy can be." "Not be so busy. Why don't we sit here, you next to me?" And so they decide to sit down on this park bench. "The birds are just like us, taking a rest, singing their song." "Our dog is tired. I think he's dreaming." I wonder if dogs dream. What do you think? Maybe. "The frog is sitting and blinking. The dragonfly has stopped beating its wings." Now everybody is resting and just being still. "Let us be quiet, like all of our friends. Quiet and still." And so that's just what they're doing. They're just sitting, relaxing, and resting. "I can think when I'm quiet." "I think better too when I'm quiet." "I can see when I'm still." You notice more when you're still, don't you think? I agree. "To be quiet and still is a special thing." And I wonder how long they sat there, still and quiet. Maybe for quite a while. And I think that's something that we can all practice doing more of. And lately, I've been doing that and meditating and taking some deep breaths. Why don't we do that right now together? I want you to take a deep breath in, the kind where you suck your belly button in, right? Take a deep breath in and blow it out. Very good. Do it again like you're getting ready to blow up a balloon. Now blow it out. Very good. I want you to pop your hand, your five fingers, and we're going to trace our hand. As we trace our hand, we're going to take those big breaths. So we'll take a deep breath in on the way up, blow it out on the way down. Can you continue to do that, my friends? Very good. Keep going. Deep breath in. Blow it out. Deep breath in. Blow it out. Yeah, whenever I need to relax or to calm down, I like to trace my hand and I like to do that. While I have my fingers up, I also like to think of five things that I'm thankful for. So will you do that with me at home too? Five things maybe that you're thankful for, or five things that make you happy. Or maybe if you're sitting by a window, you can look outside and name five things that you see in nature. Take a minute to do that right now. I'm going to think about my five things too. Okay, I'll tell you mine. You might still be looking for yours, and that's okay to keep thinking. I'm going to tell you mine. I'm thankful for Tommy DiPola and the wonderful books he gave us. I'm thankful for artwork, and I really look forward to seeing your artwork for our art gala. I'm thankful for my family. Tonight's family game night, so I get to go home and play games. I am thankful for the sunshine. It's a beautiful day out today. And I'm thankful, oh, of course, for all of you viewing at home and listening at home. I can't wait to see you again soon. Do you have your five things? Maybe you can share them with somebody at your house, somebody in your family, okay? And maybe encourage them to find five things too. All right. As promised, we were going to end today with Strega Nona, his most popular and my very favorite. Strega Nona in Italian means like grandma witch, because Strega Nona could do magical things. She even had a magic pasta pot. Can you imagine? So she made tons of spaghetti whenever she wanted. It's a wonderful story. But instead of me reading it out loud to you, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to our website, BethelParkLibrary.org, and I want you to click on the Kids tab. When you go to the Kids page and you scroll all the way down to the bottom, you'll see a link for BookFlix. Click on BookFlix and then find this title, Strega Nona. Weston Woods put on a beautiful production of it. You'll get to see Strega Nona come to life. The book comes to life. The narrator does a wonderful job. And if you enjoy it, boys and girls, I encourage you to look to check out BookFlix more often, because there's tons of titles available on there. And there's always a fiction book and then a nonfiction title to go with it. So it's something else to keep you busy in these days where you're still at home. BookFlix, and then we have lots of other wonderful databases as well. So thank you, boys and girls, for sharing in my Tommy DiPola books with me. I hope you enjoyed them as much as I did. I hope to see you again real soon. In the meantime, take care and happy reading.